بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اعلموا عباد الله أن أحسن الكلام كلام الله تبارك وتعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد عباد الله my dear brothers and sisters probably by now most of you know that my father my beloved father may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him ya Rabbil Alameen passed away last week and subhanallah it was although it's a very personal thing but there is so much khair and so much hikmah so much wisdom can be learned from personal experience when it comes to dealing with your parents. My father is a father, of course, of a family of eight, mashallah, raised eight children. And if you look at him, he's one of those typical, you know, family men who knew that their role is to make sure that their family is being secured, being taken care of, all of this while along he is taking care of his own religious duties with his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my father, when he passed away, he was 75 years old. But subhanallah, until the last, almost you could say, 3 months of his life, he was very active. Alhamdulillah, with full faculties, even independent, going to the masjid and walking. And many years before that, he lost sight in one of his eyes, and he still would go to the masjid. And I know many people, much younger, with full sight and full energy, they feel extremely hard and difficult to wake up for Fajr or even come and walk to the masjid. My father came few times here to the community. Some of you probably have met him. And when he came here, subhanAllah, I remember the first thing he would ask me when he comes into the house after he settles down, he goes, do you have a big mushaf? Because again, he struggles with his sight at that age, even with one eye. The first thing he would care about, he would say, do you have a big mushaf? I said, how big? So he was asking, the biggest you have. SubhanAllah, so I had to bring him, I have to order for him a very special mushaf which we still have at home, big enough for someone of his age and at that level to read the Quran. And every single day he would have his assignment with the Quran. He continued doing that until once again he started kind of like reaching that age we are unable to recognize and see and probably hear. SubhanAllah, it was just an unbelievable how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plans would work. He lived here for almost 19 years. And in the last 2 years, they decided just to take a break and go to their hometown where they lived in Jordan. And in just the last 3 months, for whatever reason, my mom, she said, you know what? We need to move back to the U.S. And they did. And right after they arrived over here, a month after they arrived here, subhanAllah, his condition started deteriorating. He went to the hospital. And the doctor, they said, there isn't much really that can be done. And subhanAllah, the plan is that Allah Azza wa Jal wanted him to die among his own family members, his children. And that was just like something to think about. It's just unbelievable how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned things. And with this, I would like to dedicate the khutbah for our parents, for the birrul walidain, kindness to our parents, regardless of the circumstance of our life. Wallahi, something, subhanAllah, just kind of like bothered me a lot because the last weekend before my father passed away, I was there. And I was there for 3 days and was checking on him and checking on the family and my other brothers and my mom, she kept telling me, that's enough, you go. If anything would happen, we'll call you back. And then you just look around in your life, you have to do other things and other duties to take care of, which is nothing we could get away without doing it in our lives. But then when I left, it was just 5 days. It was just 5 days while I'm just teaching in another community. My brother, who came to visit me in the hotel, he said, you know, how is the situation there? I said, listen, book a flight and go. You need to book a flight, I'll go because it's a matter of time. Although my other family members telling him, you don't have to go there. I said, just go. And he went. The next day, it was him who called me and he said, my father just passed away. But subhanAllah, many things would happen and Allah plans things in a very miraculous way, in an unbelievable way. I went there for the Aza after the burial. And I'm very grateful for many brothers and sisters and community members and leaders and imams who came and joined us actually for the funeral. SubhanAllah, I met another member of our family whose brother was a friend of my father. And he told me that was his brother actually, died the exact same day when my father passed away. Now the irony is that his brother also has the same name of my father, Hassan. And he told me that they used to be classmates and they were best friends. And they died on the exact same day, subhanAllah. One in the morning, one in the afternoon. I just want to think about all these stories, la ilaha illallah, how Allah Azza wa Jal plans things. Birul walidain, when we say birul walidain, being dutiful to your parents and kind to your parents, a lot of people, they just kind of think of it as a title. We studied this, you know, in our lectures and our Islamic education, in the masjid and weekend school, and we learn about it so much, we have just even memorized the term birul walidain to the extent that we no longer understand what does it exactly mean other than just being a formal title. Just a formal title that you're required to do birul walidain, being dutiful to your parents. But to know what does exactly mean to practice birul walidain, that is the struggle that many of us here are going through. I don't even know how to do my birul walidain, people they ask. So what does it mean? Does it mean I have to give this, I have to give that, what is it exactly? Birrul walidain is a great thing, is one of the ibadat, one of the greatest acts of worship. And I know many people, when we ask them, when you tell them to do birrul walidain, they don't think of it as an act of worship. They don't think of it as an act of worship, but they think of it as a responsibility, as a social duty probably, as a cultural obligation. No, it's not a cultural obligation. It is not a cultural obligation at all. It is actually, it's a religious duty. And it's a human duty as well, before being cultural or traditional. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, قَالَ دَخَلْتُ الْجَنَّةِ As was mentioned, Masjid Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, دَخَلْتُ الْجَنَّةِ He had a vision, salawatullah wa sallamu alayhi, in which he entered the Jannah. قَالَ فَسَمِعْتُ قِرَاءَةً I heard a recitation there, somewhere in Jannah. فَقُلْتُ مَنْ هَذَا I asked, who's this person who's reciting? قَالُوا حَارِثَةُ بْنُ النُّعْمَانِ This man was Haritha ibn al-Nu'man. Probably most of us never heard of that Sahabi before. The name is unknown to us, probably. Haritha ibn al-Nu'man. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ So the Prophet, when he heard his name, he says, كَذَلِكُمُ الْبِرُ كَذَلِكُمُ الْبِرُ This is the meaning of being dutiful to your parents. This is the meaning of being dutiful to your parents. And then, in the commentary on the hadith, the Sahaba, they said, when he read the hadith, قَالُوا وَكَانَ أَبَرَّ النَّاسِ بِأُمِّهِ He was the most dutiful to his mom. He was very famous and very well known how he was treating his mom in the best way possible. See, birul walidain, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned it right after mentioning his ibadah, the ibadah of Allah azza wa jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even mentioned this not just to us, to the people way before us. قال تعالى وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken the covenant upon the people of Bani Israel, the people of Musa alayhi salam, from way before us. He have taken the covenant, the word from them. لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ That you worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second to that, right away he said, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا And you treat your parents with ihsan. What's the meaning of ihsan? That's what we call it, birrul walidain. That's what we call birr al-walidain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said to us, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا You worship Allah and only Allah. Associate no partners with Him and worship subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then He said, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا And then about your parents, treat them with ihsan. Ihsan is mean perfection. And when people, they ask, what's the meaning of birr al-walidain? Birr, the dutifulness towards your parents. The word bir comes from the Arabic word bar. And al-bar means actually the space. Those who understand Arabic, they know that bar means actually space. It means the desert, the open space. When you say open space, what is exactly so significant about open space? It has no boundaries. Wherever you look, it's open space. There are no walls to restrict your sight or restrict your vision, nothing. It's all open space. So when it comes to bir, that's what it means. It's open, there are no boundaries to it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the people of Al-Jannah, He called them Abrar. And He called the angels Barara. And they both come from the word bir and bar as well. Why Abrar? Because Abrar means they have the perfection in terms of their khair and goodness. They're so perfect, has no limits, no boundaries of goodness. Similarly to the angels as well. And when it comes to birrul walidain, it's all about that. Birrul walidain has no boundaries. So when people ask, does it mean that I have to obey my parents? We say, yes, you need to obey your parents. Okay, does it mean to take care of them financially? We say, absolutely. Does it mean to take care of them this way or that way? In any possible way that you can think of, as long as it does not contradict with any of the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if the commands of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that should be an act of birr, an act of goodness to your parents. The Noon, one of the righteous people, one of the salihin, he said, "Qala thalathatun min alam al-birr." Three things are sign of goodness, sign of dutifulness. Qara birrul walidain. First of all, to be dutiful to your parents. Bi husni ta'ati lahuma. How? He mentioned two things. By obeying them kindly. Which means when you obey your parents, you don't obey your parents with showing, you know, kind of like that you're resisting it or just kind of like disgruntled about it and upset, and you don't show any kind of sign of that nature. You obey with full, alhamdulillah, with full gratitude and satisfaction. حُسْنِ الطَّاعَةِ لَهُمَا قَالَ وَلِينُ الْجَنَاحِ. لِينُ الْجَنَاحِ, he means by that, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Qur'an, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ, that you lower the wings of mercy to your parents. Now that's an Arabic expression, to lower the wings of humility for your parents. And that means that when you lower the wings of humility, never ever try to soar above them in whatever status that you can imagine yourself better than your parents. In knowledge, in finances, being smart or they're less smart, strength, power, whatever that is, never ever try to elevate yourself or try to fly or try to soar in any way above your parents. To that extent, قَالَ وَلِينُ الْجَنَاحِ, that you kind of like lower your wing, the wing of humility for your parents. قَالَ وَبَذْلُ الْمَالِ. بَذْلُ الْمَالِ means giving your parents generously. You give them generously. So your wealth is basically, they have the right. They have a right in your wealth as well as parents. And then he said the second kind of birr, قَالَ وَبِرُّ الْوَلَدِ, as your dutifulness towards your children, قَالَ بِحُسْنِ التَّأْدِيبِ لَهُمْ, by you treat them, you educate them properly. Meaning you raise your children with good manners, good akhlaq, so they learn the best etiquette in this life. وَالدَّلَالَةِ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ, and you guide them to that which is good. You guide your children to that which is good. Always be a guide for them. And then he said, وَبِرُّ الْجَمِيعِ النَّاسِ, as for the people in general, as for people of general, he said, you show them birr and kindness, بِطَلَاقَةِ الْوَجْهِ وَحُسْنِ الْمُعَاشَرَةِ, smiling in their faces. You smile in the face of strangers, neighbors, friends, people who are around you. وَحُسْنِ الْمُعَاشَرَةِ, and the best treatment, best interaction with them. Which means with good manners again, and good akhlaq. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was the best example for us in that. Although, we don't know many stories from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about birrul walidain, because, subhanAllah, his father died before he was even born, and his mom died when he was a child, salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. But some of that birr that we have seen from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's, you know, parents, when he asked Allah azza wa jal to allow him to visit the grave of his mother, and he was allowed to do that. So he visited the grave, salawatullah wa salam alayhi. Upon standing on that grave, he cried. Can you imagine a man in his 50s, salawatullah wa salam alayhi, standing at the grave of his mother, and he cries. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they cried as well. They sympathized because they know that's human. It's very natural. And it's okay. If people, they get emotions, subhanAllah, at that moment when you remember, these are your parents. And why is that? For us Muslims, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he instructed us, if you're looking for Jannah, you'll find it there. Your parents are two gates to Al-Jannah. Your parents, these are two gates to Al-Jannah. These are just green tickets, basically, green lights for you and tickets to Al-Jannah. As long as they're alive, you make sure that you take care of them. Make sure that you take care of them. And if one of them passed away, that means one door is closing. You better catch up before the other one is actually closes as well. Now the last thing, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed us also to take care of our parents even long after they're gone. So the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they were curious about it. Because some of them, they missed the opportunity probably taking care of their parents. They died. And they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, is there any way that we can take care of our parents or do birrul walidayn after our parents are gone from this life? Qala sallallahu alaihi wasallam, na'am, bis salati alayhima wal istighfari lahuma wa infadi ahdihima min ba'dihima wa silatul rahim allati la tusalu illa bihima wa ikramu sadiqihima. He says sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as salatu alayhima, that means you pray salatul janaza and you make dua for them. Janaza and dua, which means doesn't matter how busy you are, doesn't matter what schedule you have, if that was a moment for them, you have to be there. You have to interrupt everything and go and be there, because these are your parents now. And then he said, "Wal istighfaru lahuma," that you seek forgiveness for them, particularly from the dua that you give, that you seek forgiveness for your parents. And then he said, "Wa infadu ahdihima min ba'dihima," that whatever pledges they've given, make sure to fulfill that. If they promise people with anything, you go and you try to fulfill that. And that's why a tradition, and the tradition people, they do at the grave site, before the person is actually put into the grave, they ask, does anyone, you know that this person or the deceased owes them anything? If they have pledged anything for you, if you promise with anything, please let us know, we'll take care of it for you. Because they want to make sure that when their deceased is actually laid put there in the grave, that alhamdulillah, everything will be covered for them. And that is part of birr al-walidain as well. وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَصِلَةُ الرَّحِمُ أَلَّتِي لَا تُوصَلُ إِلَّا بِهِمَا. And maintain the tie of kinship. That kinship that cannot be maintained without you being linked to them through the person who died. Your parents, your mom and your dad. So whether your uncles, your cousins, their uncles probably, grandparents and so on. You make sure to maintain that dutifulness through the relatives that you have around you. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ikramu sadiqihima. And now you go to the bigger circle. Not just their relatives, even their friends. Even their friends, their neighbors, their co-workers, people they knew from before. So whenever you see them somewhere, you go and you maintain that relationship with them. And you're making sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala write their legacy long after they're gone through you as being a dutiful child. And beautiful, actually, kid of their own parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given our parents another opportunity after they're gone through us. Therefore, I urge each and every one of us, if your parents are gone from this world, that you take the opportunity, that you fulfill these obligations and these duties towards your parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our parents, ya Rabbil Alameen. Give them Jannat al-Firdaus al-A'la, ya Rahman, ya Rahim. Aqulu qawli hada wa astaghfirullah al-azim wa li walakum. Wa lisaamu sabina fa astaghfiruhu, innahu al-ghafur al-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ثم أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters, I know many people, they might have this question in their minds right now, saying, but that's in the ideal relationship between parents and children. But what about if the parents, maybe they would be difficult, if they ask you for things that might not be in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now if they ask you and command you to do whatever that is that would displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَلَا طَاعَةِ لِمَخْلُوقٌ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ. There is no obedience to any creature if that entails the disobedience to the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not even parents. But when it comes to other issues, obviously as human beings, you know, we have our own, alhamdulillah, desire to become independent and moving on with life, and making sure that, you know, fulfill our duties to other people in our lives as well, spouse and children and others and so on. Sometimes it's come in conflict with our parents, you know, maybe requests and desires. How do you handle these issues? Now that's a difficult situation. It cannot be answered in a khutbah. And it's a case-by-case scenario. But what we've been required to do, even when times is difficult, when time is difficult dealing with parents, still you are commanded, you are being ordered to make sure that you maintain the best of akhlaq and manners with your parents. It doesn't matter. So if they ask you something that is out of your league, out of your hand, you still need to respond in that which is best, as much as you can. It's your test. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of you, Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma alimna ma anfa'na, wa anfa'na bima alamtana, innaka anta al-alim al-hakim. Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha, wa zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha, anta waliyuha mawlaha. عباد الله إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وارض اللهم عن خلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان يوم الدين وأقم الصلاة